Welcome to our lecture series. We are Gender Socialism, Post-Socialism Group at the Davis Center at Harvard University. And we're honored to have our guest speaker today, Farah Karapetyan. Farah Karapetyan is an artist and public thinker based in California who works with narratives of human agency. She holds a BA from Yale University and an MFA from the University of California at Los Angeles. Her work is in multiple public collections, including the J. Paul Getty Museum and the San Francisco Museum of Modern Art. She said she has received fellowships from the Fulbright Program when she went to Russia in 2018, the Paula Krasner Foundation, the California Community Foundation, and the Center for Cultural Innovation. Her writing about visual and civic experience has been recognized by multiple publications and by the Creative Capital Warhol Foundation Arts Writers Grant Program. Without any further ado, Farah, the floor is yours. We're really honored to have you here.
Thank you so much. It's so good to meet you. I am going to share my screen. One moment while I work it out. Presenter view. All right. So, this is a photograph by Anastasia Khoroshilova of a man named Mahmed carving out a space for himself in Russia by closing his eyes. It's from a series of images the Russian-born and based artist made from 2011 to 2012, in which migrants from former Soviet republics to Moscow hold space inside their minds. But what kind of a space are they picturing when that journey isn't just geographic, but inflected by political changes that literally turned them into migrants, whereas formerly they would have shared identity with potentially with their photography? The post-Soviet subject, you know, it's the title of my lecture begs a lot of questions. Who's affiliated with the notion of the post-Soviet? And which types of representation does such a subject assert their agency? Which types of representation does their work resist? Which constructs maybe enable that assertion, both in terms of contemporary systems of dissemination and historical reference points native to the region? And, you know, if I, an artist from California, am involved in their centering by speaking of it in organized terms, how is what I'm doing distinct from some kind of imperialist project of discovery, taxonomy, revelation of a region? I hope it's not, but we'll see. What I'm trying to observe actually here is a shift in meta-narrative before and after the political rupture of the Soviet Union's collapse. Shifts that both disrupt people's senses of selves and at this point enable their elaboration. We've moved from a centrally planned project of inclusivity, flawed but inclusive of ethnicities and women through relationships to labor and ideology, to a system the laws of which are reflected in a meta-narrative of white heteronormativity in Russia that excludes the very parts of society revolution worked to include. So how does the work of artists affiliated with the former Soviet Union, as well as the various contexts available for their work's development and dissemination, feed back into this phenomenon and potentially shift it? I want to begin with one such subject, one such artist engaging in the subject's role, speaking for herself, in other words, to set the tone for what I mean, before rolling back into context and then forward again into other contemporary artworks. I hope this will clarify from the get-go what I mean by centering a subject. Taus Makhacheva was born in 1983 in Moscow. She's descended from the Avars, the predominant ethnic group in Dagestan. Her mother's an art historian, her mother's father was the poet Rasul Gamzatov, and her mother's mother was the first director of Dagestan Museum of Fine Arts. She studied photography and fine art at the London College of Communication, Goldsmiths University of London, Moscow's Institute of Contemporary Art, and London's Royal College of Art. She now lives and works between Moscow, Dagestan, and London. Her work reflects affiliations with all of these locations, and more importantly, takes the subject position, the agent acting and observing rather than the object observed, as she moves poetically through landscapes and characters and performance that's communicated primarily through photography and video. In Endeavor, this video from 2010, and a lot of the work I'm showing today is video or film, but I'm showing stills, Makhacheva throws her weight against a boulder that has been hanging over the Dagestani village of Sada for centuries. It's a work drawing on romantic tradition as much as the structure of Caucasian society, right? And the video relies on the kind of notion that one take a landscape personally, its ramifications resounding through the stresses that you can hear from the panting body of the artist. She's pushing and pushing and nothing changes. In the beginning, the exercise, in beginning it at all, she knew it one of futility, but she did it anyway. Like the kind of 500 Peruvian volunteers in Belgian-born Mexican-based Francis Alice's When Faith Moves Mountains, who shovel sand several inches over the course of a day, but fail to change the landscape. Makhacheva's endeavor de-romanticizes land art, but politicizes it at the same time. It's a subject position Taos looks at a lot in her work. What are any of our relationships as individuals to the authority of a group? How far will we go to fit in? And how does our presence as an outsider change the very nature of the way we look at authenticity and insiderness? Rehan was shot between two mountain villages in the Republic of Dagestan. A young man, which you can see here, wearing a traditional sheepskin coat called a timug that's usually worn by shepherds, integrates himself into a flock of sheep. While briefly accepted, as you can see by the nosy sheep on the bottom left, he's abandoned eventually as an other. Relying on local traditions, again embodied in performance, the work actually contends with social relations. What are we ready to do in order to be included in any one society's we? In 2015, Taos was ready to push the precarity of our relationship to landscape and history. She asked Rasul Abakarov from the fifth generation of a Dagestani tightrope dynasty to cross a canyon in the Caucasus Mountains, holding, instead of a balancing pole, 61 copies of works from the collection of the Dagestani Museum of Fine Art, encapsulating the history of 20th century art in the region. Each time he achieved the end of the line, he would place copies in a structure that resembles a museum storage unit. For Makhacheva personally and for creative professionals in general, of course, this has to do with the precarity of careers and the question of what makes it into history. But the landscape and the work elected to represent that history is specific. That ravine's not just any ravine, the tightrope walker, not just any tightrope walker. The collection one directed again at one time by Makhacheva's grandmother, and the works even including a picture of her poet grandfather meeting Che Guevara. What it means to take the subject position is to take generalizable conditions personally and to find one's own way in. Makhacheva has an alter ego, a superhero called Super Taos, who she developed, she says, in recognition and homage to all my female relatives who perform heroic tasks in their daily lives. In the picture on the right, she's holding, as she usually does when pictured, a 300 kilogram sculpture of Maria Korkmasova and Kamisat Abdullayeva, the two Dagestani museum attendants who saved a Rodchenko painting from a robber with a knife in the 1990s. Super Taos wears the inexpensive daily clothing typical of women living in northern Dagestan and sturdy black shoes, which have become a part of the narrative of banal heroism that is one of the larger aims of this project. Super Taos has extraordinary strength, walking between the capital of Dagestan and Moscow and Paris with this portable monument looking for its rightful home. But where is the home of a monument to the invisible art care workers that it represents, or to the notion of labor and women's contribution therein? In 2019, Super Taos offered viewers at least two ways to participate in her project. In one, called Quick Fix, she offered to engrave one of 100 trophies she had found on Amazon and AliExpress with the achievement of your choice, just in case you dreamt of winning something but never quite made it. Also, she incorporated into the project an initiative called the Superhero Sighting Society, which makes issue of the archive and of bureaucracy, insofar as a records clerk listens to and records stories from all over the world that describe small acts of heroism in our everyday life. As these acts are inscribed into history, the otherwise helpless state of the individual acting alone becomes perhaps a collective, if scattered, if virtual, as are all things utopian now. As a final introduction to both Makhacheva's work and to the idea of the post-Soviet subject position, while I could describe many others of her works, I'll mention Charivari, an installation Makhacheva made in 2019 in Azerbaijan. I chose this work because I love it, but also because it exemplifies several themes you'll see elsewhere in this argument. So far, we've seen valorized states of gender and ethnic and class identities, questions of the group versus the individual, and of history making through performance relayed through photo and video. But I want to stress A, the interrelationship of mediums in the art practice of the post-Soviet space, as well as B, the kinds of spaces available to artists locally, even while Taos, like Taos, some of them exhibit internationally as well. The playfulness a lot of this work as a deliberate form of subversion native to the region, and the reliance not just on local codes like sheepskin coats and anecdotes around attempts at burglarizing Rodchenkos, but intentional recovery of local archives as supporting material for a revolutionary sense of self that does not rely on the West, even as it's conversant with it. Charivaris exist all over the world, but in this case, we're talking about the history of the USSR's widespread circus tradition and the Baku National Circus in particular. Circuses in regional capitals such as Baku served as a way of expressing state-approved versions of the many national identities incorporated into the Soviet Union, and yet allowed for further testing of limits, more liberty than perhaps than did socialist realist representations, which were didactic and prescribed. The subversion possible in a circus space is something that interests Makhachyeva, and she worked with a team to create this wrought iron skeleton of an imagined context, as well as the costumes that would be worn by performers over the course of the exhibition's development. The Charivari is a specific moment in a circus when multiple performances proceed simultaneously, including sound and animals, and Makhachyeva achieved this level of intentional chaos with Alexander Snegorev's monologues booming from speakers, a birth, I would totally show you, but I can't find a picture of it happening in the arena, a fly in a silver cape, and a strong woman accountant. We're talking about Baku last year, and if today's news about Azerbaijan has crossed your path, you know that the country's current regime is engaging in soft power exercises using oil money for construction to hope many international spectacles, as well as war. The government donated the former Soviet naval building in which this art center is housed. Its founder and creative director is the president's niece, the painter Aida Mahmudova. But to an artist like Makhachyeva, it's more important to have a site for subjectivity and criticality than it is at this moment to follow the money. By the way, Azerbaijan also has the Baku Art Center, launched in the mid-1980s, and a history and present of projects produced locally in the post-colonization period, such as through the group Labyrinth, which I encourage you to read more about through Sabina Abasova's comprehensive report in CEC Arts Link's recent publication focused on socially engaged art, A Miracle or Misunderstanding, which is available on CEC Arts Link's website. More about them later. Anyway, Makhachyeva used her exhibition in Baku to research the history of the place and its representations, and to reveal that history publicly, yes, in her own work, but also online, where she's put together an archival film about the circus. This is important so we don't walk into this work as Western viewers and just see Calder, and so that local viewers don't walk into it and see just soft power's market success. Exhibitions like this are conversations as much about history and recovery as they are about contemporaneity. Makhachyeva Charivari invokes not only circus traditions, but also clarifies her work and other contemporary artists' relationship to revolutionary practices, especially in the history of the region. In other works, Makhachyeva has wrapped foods in Mayakovsky poems and otherwise referred back to that period of utopian imagining before the codification of a Soviet metanarrative. In this one, the Charivari, through her use of text, costumes, and set design, as much as through the actual look of that set design itself and its intentional playfulness, she really specifically recalls Barbara Stepanova's sets and costumes for Meyerhold's 1922 production of Death of Tarelkin, the constructivist vision of Tsarist Russia, or Lyuba Popova's set for Meyerhold's Magnanimous Kukold of the same year. These revolutionary women's set designs were supposed to reach the proletariat in ways I've discussed elsewhere, so I won't get into it. But suffice it to say, it was fun. The intention was fun. It was bodily, it was stylized, and it threw you out of the Aristotelian kind of suction cup of normal narrative, wherein drama leads to catharsis and political apathy. Here, the audience would engage its own critical thinking in as much as did those on stage, leading to political change. So now that I hope you've kind of fallen in love with the terms of Taos's work, I want to back up. In 2007, not to hold him to it per se, but artist and critic Evgeny Fix posited in the Moscow Art Magazine that post-Soviet art of the 1990s and 2000s privileged irresponsibility, indeed exemplified a programmatic and conscientious rejection of responsibility towards the politics of cultural production and the active positing of what the terms post-communism, post-socialism, and indeed post-Soviet might signify. In recent brief correspondence, I clarified with him that he meant not only an irresponsibility in terms of apolitical production, perhaps, but of political engagement, such as the Islamic project of the artist collective AES plus F, which in 1996 seemed to stoke fears about a Muslim takeover of the world. Fix went so far as to suggest that the community of Marxist artists and intellectuals such as Stodzielet, What Is to Be Done, based in St. Petersburg, were at that point not really fitting the bill, the kind of didacticism of a group named for Chernyshevsky's novel and revolutionary resource of 1863 was not what he meant as far as getting the work done at that moment. I take Yevgeny's writing to pose the question of what might be a radical shift in self-expectations of the post-Soviet artist towards a position of social commitment and responsibility. That responsibility, he said, cannot pass to the government, capitalism, nor the West. The present-day post-Soviet context need be, he seems to suggest, a workplace for critical agency. So in the 13 years since Fix published that essay, What Is Being Done? It's a question. He, for example, has consistently worked on projects around the history of the left and focused on microhistorical narratives of Soviet history, such as not only in artwork such as this video in which Soviet propaganda is juxtaposed against audio featuring post-Soviet LGBTQ plus speaking about the impossibility of queer or gay utopia, but in also his upcoming book, Queering Russian Art, Realism, Revolution, and Performance. So through very particular institutional frameworks, grassroots cosmopolitanism, and probably the internet, of course, indeed artists across the post-Soviet space have introduced the kind of agency I think Fix was looking for into the frameworks of what they do. They've taken that subject position rather than the object position in their art making and dissemination, by which I mean, again, to use the philosophical definition therein, they've become the observer rather than the observed, the actors rather than the acted upon. And I don't mean this to sound utopian, because in this arena, that word is a trigger. I simply mean to observe the presence of this phenomenon. It is, rather than it is aspirational. I believe that artists today are taking responsibility for helping us to see an avant-garde revolutionary history and a Soviet one and how those build into today. But, you know, it does sound utopian. So why? What are the artists up against? What are individuals up against in terms of seeing themselves mirrored in contemporary representation? Example of contemporary pop culture in the Russian Federation, which I really enjoyed researching, which reflects the current state's meta-narrative, is Major, Silver Spoon, the Russian crime drama produced by Streda for Channel One Russia. Russian TV show was the first to be acquired by Netflix. It tells the story of an oligarch's son, Igor, whose father, who of course made his money in the 90s, punishes Igor for his laziness by forcing him to work at a Moscow police station, where he discovers the truth about his mother's death, learns the value of hard work, and for the purposes of this lecture, provides countless examples of the new normal in Russian representation. His fiancée is a rich blonde who spends her time on beauty rituals, and despite the main character's personal trajectory away from a life of drunken leisure, the show privileges the privileged in many ways and sanctifies his dead mother, who provided him with a childhood brought to an abrupt end by his demise. It especially establishes a norm of nativism. Almost every case the police solves involves a migrant. Migrants from Armenia and Georgia represent wealthy crime rings. Uzbeks are builders or illiterate tools in the cops' schemes. And often migrants threaten the honor of Russian girls, as in this episode in which a Russian father has killed an Azerbaijani neighbor. Before he confesses, he asks his wife for vodka, and wearing a Russian Navy shirt under his flannel, he explains his position to the cops. Sveta is everything we have. He was harassing her all the time. The migrant has violently raped his daughter. And worse, he's disabled her from having children. The system has failed him. And the cops visibly empathize with his situation. and he'd kill him again if he had a chance. So this narrative is not unique to Silver Spoon and stands in stark contrast 37 years later to representations of friendship between ethnicities in Soviet films such as Mimino of 1977, in which a Georgian bush pilot and Armenian truck driver adventure in Moscow together, or the privileging of Far Eastern indigenous knowledge in Dersu Uzala, the narrative about the Nanai trapper who worked as a guide for Vladimir Arsenyev, which Arsenyev wrote about in 1923 and which was made into films in both 1961 and 1975, or the meta-narrative that served as propaganda in the Soviet photo book, which emphasized the productivity of working people, working women across the Soviet space. It's a transition in meta-narratives one can watch unfold over the course of the evolution of the women's magazine Rabotnitsa, female worker, created in 1914 and still in circulation today, but oh so differently. Online below advertisements, the categories discussed include career among health, house, children, beauty, and relationships. But even in this section are articles about how to become an actor or an influencer. And the only recent mention of ethnicity is about the People's Friendship University of Russia, the project of which is to assist in identifying and reducing the level of social tension and radicalism in the student environment, as well as ensuring the socio-cultural adaptation of foreign citizens and their integration into Russian society. Obviously, these Soviet magazines and movies were part of a central plan. The first issue of the women's magazine, Krestyanka, Peasant Woman, was published in 1922 as an appeal by the All-Russian Central Executive Committee, Kalinin, to introduce Soviet women to the country's social and cultural life. And the first issue of the magazine included a free supplement called Down with Illiteracy. On the left, we have a cover from 1985 that reads, Zina is 18 years old. This year, she became a tractor driver and has already won the audience award in the 11th USSR Plowman competition. On the right, I believe the last issue, Krestyanka grew from a circulation of 5,000 copies to almost 400,000 in 2015. When it closed, at which point its focus had shifted to recipes and ideas for a really good New Year's Eve celebration. So representations of Russians in the US or post-Soviet space in the US began to mirror the meta-narrative coming out of the Federation, so that in the last few years, the notions of the radical ideological threat that the Soviet Union used to represent have disappeared. With the exception of the exceptional FX original series, The Americans, gone are ideological references to the worker, especially the working woman, or to class references, or to class unity among ethnicities and indeed races. Instead, Russia is a hot blonde spy or a mail order black bride. Russia is a thriller or a horror film when it is not, as it is perpetually in the US news, simply a synonym for election fraud. This is to say that the notion of the Russian is effectively now represented inside and outside the Federation by the Slavic featured person pursuing capitalist affiliated goals of white collar success, even if violently achieved, and heteronormative family relations, even if over sexualized when villainized. Although this is not centrally planned, it exists in a feedback loop between government decision making and civic practice that can seem impenetrable. An example of civic practice, right, would be advertisements for apartments in Russia, which often note that only Slavs will be considered as tenants. And of course, civic practice and civic experience can be traced to laws, with such a described by social scientists such as Damien Chevel and Madeline Reeves, or time and time again in the ethnographic accounts relayed by Svetlana Alexeyevich, the people figured as others in rental advertisements or in soap operas or erased from the pages of contemporary magazines. That's a shift that only a very productive civic imagination can question. Here an account by Reeves of a man from Kyrgyzstan who only truly processed the fall of the Soviet Union through his experience of becoming a migrant, indeed becoming what is literally referred to as Black, being positioned as such, rather than being positioned through law, representations, and civic practice as one of a common society. And I can, make handy timelines as well of other kinds of trajectories around the way that laws feed into civic practice and representations and meta narratives, such as those position gender and sexuality in terms of their impact on family at all, let alone that then impact notions of the family that kind of exclude to the exclusion of queer lives as prescriptive of women's lives and et cetera. But the guiding question of this talk is who can take responsibility for shifting the narrative? Who has the civic imagination to do that? And how can artists inside of particular identities assert their existence as an authentic thing? I exist. I am here, rather than as something defined from the outside. And, you know, photography and videos are natural interventions into vernacular culture. So it might be natural to look to them as practices to combat the construction of an exclusive regional identity. A lot of the photography that's most publicized coming out of Russia, though, doesn't quite do what Fix was calling for in terms of social commitment and responsibility. It looks at the Soviet period, but often in terms of ruin porn. And there's nothing wrong with these kinds of taxonomies per se. In fact, they may be a very important first step for thinking through stages of admiration and loss. But you know, my question is, do they create a sense of agency? It's not the only way artists are looking at dilapidation through photography. For example, with Sergei Sapozhnikov's black and white photographs that I see personally as a Russian new topographics, or his performative uses of that landscape's banal excesses, or Roma Makrov's post-industrial pastorals, which are playful, again, with a space of loss rather than simply documentary of it. You can see just now that Makrov in his biography went to school officially for psychology. And honestly, it's not within most photographic higher education that I'm finding people whose work reflects postures of diversity, let alone subjectivity. And there are some reasons for that. The Soviet Union had quotas in education, rural areas, Soviet republics, there were numbers. And because of the ways in which housing and education and food are regulated, you know, art schools, although I don't have this statistic yet, I need to do more research if I want to understand. Art schools were potentially populated by diverse peoples and also situated in these various republics, right? They're not necessarily in the big cities. And in thinking about resistance to contemporary lens-based meta-narratives, I had to ask a group of photographers through a few networks in Russia to slightly more scientifically clarify who's currently being educated and how. Given that 52% of respondents were my age, the majority of them, you know, 35 to 40, would have experienced the transition in representational strategies and educational context with respect to photography and video constituted by the end of the Soviet Union. Everyone identified as being from the Russian Federation, suggesting that these networks are fairly ethnically homogenous. To further clarify this homogeneity, I asked if they worked with people they would call foreign, and if so, what were their roles? The majority by far said that they did not work or study with foreigners in their photographic context, although some cited cleaning staff, while others noted that foreigners sold their work or were guests of international photography festivals. This isn't supposed to be conclusive evidence that Russian higher education and museum contexts are primarily populated currently by ethnic Russians, but it's of note, especially given prior histories of quotas. And also especially as this lecture is suggesting that the notion of post-Sovietness, Russianness even, why not, is an open question to be worked on by those whose practice it is to represent. And it was also important for me to ask where they learned photography. Almost 30% were self-taught, 16 or so percent were taught in a journalism program, 12-ish in a club, and then art, and in descending order, photography, graphics, and various combinations. The theorists they read include Roland Barthes and Susan Sontag, but also guidelines for unmediated photo composition by Dico and Lapin, who I have not read. Photographers they mentioned studying also trended towards the document, for example, Cartier-Bresson, Boris Ignatovich, and Joseph Kudelka, admirable observers, all people who write or photograph from the perspective of the observer, though, rather than from the perspective of the subject, which is, again, my interest here. That's what I'm looking for. What is the position of the subject, not simply the observer? And what is the position of the author as subject? So I kept looking. The photographers I surveyed, I tried to get closer to their subject position, how they'd grown up, rather than just relying on conversation. Their exposure to lens-based mediums on a vernacular level was equally diverse to their educational strategies. You know, watching VHS tapes and video salons undercover as kids, seeing Soviet cartoons and family archives until the 80s when they started to see soap operas like Santa Barbara and then MTV. So, okay, if photography MFA programs like those with which I'm familiar in California are not where people are being educated in a region that very much obviously values education. Where are these influences coming from? And I'm not going to go through a timeline of education, but there is something important about where photography, where experimental practices were situated in the moment of kind of codification of the Soviet metanarrative as it moved from revolution to strict central planning. And I was just really interested to listen to my colleague Dmitry Fomin present about how its more experimental methodologies were housed in graphic departments intentionally in 1924, so that the potential of the medium to contain agitation or propaganda against Soviet power, to divulge state secrets, to arouse nationalist or religious fanaticism, all the rules of socialist realism, right? Registers, pornographic, all of that was limited, to say the least, by the kind of overwhelming emphasis on the document in strict photographic processes. So what you do have, because of the hiding of experimental practices within graphics or other industrial arts, is samizdat, or for those unfamiliar with that term, the clandestine copying and distribution of literature by, banned by the state, or also just self-publishing of officially unpublishable ideas. And this is a tradition that persists today, an example of which is Nasreddin in Russia, the fourth issue of which I picked up in 2018. It's named after the Turkish trickster, and it's a newspaper co-produced by migrants and artists led by Olga Jitina and Anna Tereshkina to describe issues relevant to the daily life of people living and working in Russia who have the identity now of migrant. We've already talked about how that's a construction, but in any case, this newspaper is obviously printed in several languages per page as relevant to the content and theoretically to the reader. The categories of migrant and artist aren't always mutually exclusive, as especially exemplified in issue 3, which looks at the differences and similarities between the groups who share unstandardized labor without paid vacations, sick leave, or pension plans, driving themselves to exhaustion through self-exploitation. It acknowledges, as is the Marxist want of the paper, that the labor of one of these categories is alienated, while that of the other is about self-realization and self-expression. Their fifth issue was set to be published by the Garage Museum of Contemporary Arts, Bureau des Transmissions, a transnational project that activated the campus of the institution with artists acting as experts and education taking on the role of social activist. In my mind, the Bureau is an institutionalization of samizdat, almost, taking common practices that persist, such as with the feminist publishing of Daria Apakmuntich, Gardner's Femme Italis Pro, couched as children's books, and suggesting it as the future of museums, but playfully, always with games. Daria actually is an example of an artist who's pushing back against the meta-narrative of gender and indeed the artist's role in a changing society. Her projects go beyond the subversive books, these wonderful children's books about feminism, and into photography, qua vernacular photography, including a funny project depicted here called Men Relaxing, which shows men lying down, taking literally the offer stenciled into the street that actually denotes prostitution. It says relax and offers a phone number, but somehow, you know, meditation isn't what's implied. And the photographs are the artist's statement constituting activism in a public space. By the way, Daria also teaches Russian to migrants, participates in the group Rodina, not the nationalist one, but the feminist one, and performs alongside other artists to support, for example, the artist Yulia Svetkova, who faced the gay propaganda charge 3 times last year because of running an online page called the Vagina Monologues. And because of posting on Contact about intersectional feminism and picture of happy queer families. And in light of that, I also want to mention Ozine for sure as a Russian site for visibility in the queer community. And as, you know, in a way, this kind of contemporary evolution of self-publishing, right? There are other new media forms of what I'll continue to affiliate with notions of self-publishing that circumvent mass media pressures. Ksenia Diodorova at Gonzo Design is for sure a graphic designer and a photographer, but her gestures are towards co-production with her subjects, such as with this project around Armenians and how they self-describe, or an educational platform for storytelling co-taught in Kyrgyzstan. Her multimedia project in the cold takes her to Tajikistan and back, providing didactics for a community who doesn't understand the people in their midst, but also functioning as a connective tissue for the people she meets, insofar as she visits the relatives both in Tajikistan and Moscow and connects them through representation. There's also Igor Isayev's documentary, Behind the Wall, which was filmed on the centenary of the October Revolution in 2017, where we see a Polish anthropologist and a Russian journalist show up at the construction of this park to talk to a few of the 5,000 workers who made it happen. The day workers are from the Kyrgyz Republic and Tajikistan. In the evening, we see people from various regions of Russia, Tatarstan, Bashkiria, et cetera. I don't know how to characterize these projects, Nasruddin in Russia, Ksenia's work at Gonzo, or Igor Isayev's film, without tying them to the history of one-on-one engagement with the other. Sincere conversation that leads to mutual education, since Chernyshevsky. It's Marxist and it's helpful and it's fascinating, and I love the trust building. I love it all. It's not didactic in the way I think I'm reading Fuchs as having described work in the 90s, but it's also not quite the centered subject that I'm seeking. So I'm going to kind of disrupt the documentary trajectory that I was just on and transitioning to a project of German Lavrovsky's to test my question of insider representation in the post-Soviet space, a project called Reborn that's housed on Garage Digital Projects. I'm jogging us out of this comfort zone of the other as migrant or even the artist born during Soviet times, because Lavrovsky was not, to think about the notion of gender and sexuality as at all tied to family. So disrupting this meta-narrative from the inside of an existence that one owns as other from the dominant narrative, right? So when Lavrovsky was 16, he began working in the fashion industry, and his interest in what he called the contemporary visual economies of gender and historical experiments with post-nuclear family relationships is cited always on public platforms as open code and free of copyright. In the meta-narrative Soviet space, the child was often figured as an opposing force to the bourgeois system, a pioneer. In the meta-narrative of the post-Soviet space, the child is the justification for propaganda laws around sexuality or for Silver Spoon's cops to empathize with the murderer of a migrant. The child is a political agent, as Lavrovsky recently mentioned in a talk at Philadelphia's Print Center, supporting a variety of Russian societal norms and narratives. So Reborn was an attempt, as he said, to hack the family code. He printed a 3D baby and uses it as an incubator to practice, as he says, radical hospitality and as an apparatus of queer kinship. When you go to play the game, you see a psychodrama unfold as if joining Vera Schmidt's 1921 Detsky Dom, children's home, also known as the Solidarity International Experimental Home, with something residents of Berkeley, California would have experimented with in the 1970s. The Schmidt reference is intentional and transcribed. If she was then in the revolutionary context designing the new man, the builder of communism, what can we do now? How can we redesign care to include its multiple forms? And you can see in these pictures, individuals interacting with the 3D printed baby and really interrogating what the space of family might be. So how, by extension, is the art form here a form of care? How does it reflect the agency of an individual to be able to speak for themselves and for this kind of reinvention of a civic imagination around what is? Rather than documenting queer bodies, it's an imagination from the inside of what family might in fact be in the Russian space, post-Soviet space. So you can look at these last few projects in a kind of a tradition of samizdat, of the communist co-teaching, co-learning environment, but with the introduction of Lavrovsky's kind of playful gaming environment, that environment of self-design, we need something else local that's influencing visual culture in the last 40 years. You know, even though he was born in the 90s and is influenced by fashion and games more per se than anything that happened per se during Soviet times. You know, he's referring to Schmidt. He's drawing on local history. So again, what are they in the lens-based sphere? Everyone knows by now, of course, about the underground during the Soviet period, or unofficial artists who got together in kvartirniks, apartment shows, to read poetry and play music, and indeed occasionally take pictures of their new girlfriends or landscapes of melancholy back streets rather than constantly trying to affirm the state's positivist goals that excluded pornography and failure from representation. But it's not until the 70s that photography truly begins to participate in a subjective sense of social commitment by documenting performance across the Soviet Union. This is uncannily similar in terms of timeline to what Jeff Wall describes in his 1995 essay, Marks of Indifference, as the process through which photography entered fine arts processes of autocritique, mediating the conceptual art of the 1960s and 70s and undergoing therein process of amateurization, valorizing vernacular idioms. Photography became an avenue through which people could report subjectively on their own experience of what was going on. So in brief correspondence in 2019 with contemporary critic Vladimir Levashov, I asked him his opinion of this, but he was skeptical. He thought perhaps that now selling photos of the conceptual and underground happenings in Russia was a factor of the new market. I don't really mean that this was art, that the photograph was art, and that it is therefore entering the market as art. I mean to say that without these pictures as a local connector of what photography and video can contribute to perspectives on poetic action, you don't arrive at Taoist Makhachev. You literally don't have permission to provide a video or a succession of photographs as a form of artwork without these pictures. Regard, kind of as, I mean, it's important to imagine that this happened on a very basic level for a formulation of what's possible to use, maybe, to reformat a civic imagination. You have to see your reality transformed before you can realize you can transform reality on some level, right? Regard, as an example, Golnara and Kasmalieva's and Muratbek Jumaliev's work in photography and video. Born in 1960 and 65 in Kyrgyzstan, especially for a moment, their New Silk Road, Algorithm of Survival and Hope, which they made in 2006. If you just dwell on this picture and let it become sculptural for you while I talk about how they live and work in Bishkek, Kyrgyzstan, and how they've dedicated themselves to the task of cultivating a vibrant community there for contemporary art. All Soviet infrastructures for the education and support of artists are gone, and there are no models for private, philanthropic, corporate, or foundation assistance. So the artist partners joined with others in 2003 to incorporate their own NGO called Art East, which promotes partnerships with helpful outsiders and provides various kinds of facilities and studios. They've also made a couple of Bishkek international exhibitions of contemporary art. So when you look at their documentation of the Silk Road, think about that. When institutions fail us, we become our own institutions. And they did. Where once Marco Polo and caravans of camels walked along with luxuries, Kasmalieva and Jumaliev made art fairs and document fleets that move cargo, breeding entrepreneurial communities of rural villagers to makeshift towns along the road. People adapt. After 75 years of compulsory settlement and collective farming under Soviet rule, these villagers now rely on trade and still call the thoroughfare the Silk Road. The trucks in these pictures sort and pack scrap metal for truck transport between Kyrgyzstan and Western China. And in the course of the five-channel installation, you end up seeing patterns in global economics that include celebrations in the mountainscapes and Kyrgyz ballads sung and played on accordion. Finally, a boy on horseback races a truck. And as the truck leaves the kid in the dust, instead of kind of sadness in that loss, you see the boy's eagerness, that kind of sweet young energy that's only human, not just marginalized or left behind. So there's a difference between how people self-represent and how one might represent a Kyrgyz life from the outside. Kasmalieva and Jumaliev aren't looking to represent that kind of marginalization and loss in this project. They're curious and amused by halal hamburgers in this New Silk Road. It's impossible to exoticize or categorize or call post anything because it is. As a last building block of the 20th century kind of arsenal subjectivity and presence, I'll mention the pirate TV program of 1989 to 1992. It was on state TV and through pirate connections to cable TV stations, and it represents, like Samusdat, that playful eliding of official space so characteristic of production under strict conditions. That's where I locate the origins of subjectivity in Soviet and now Soviet practice, not in the first uncensored exhibitions or the first fashion biennials, and certainly not in photography programs in universities. These are kind of like, I think, Western ideas of progress, but in the documentation of conceptual and political practice, pirate TV has a building block from earlier video salons, and believers like Kasmalieva and Jumaliev, who were just like, oh, there's no system, let's be the system. Those kinds of representations all contribute to the idea that reality is a construction. Magazine covers are impenetrable cultural signals, as are documentary photographs. They read as aspirations, if not as absolute fact. They don't seem constructed. They seem real, magazines do. They're all too real, all too unattainable, these lives pictured in these magazines. I think it's interesting to look at Diana Markosyan in this respect. As with every artist I'll mention, her post-Soviet affiliation is complicated. She grew up and was educated in the States after her mother became a mail order bride with someone in Santa Barbara. Her first work was documentary, and in fact, the reputable agency Magnum invited her to be part of their program. But when she really began to look at her family's history, she began to think of authenticity as located somewhere other than just in front of her. When you look at her work, you see the photograph become more and more a site of intervention, as here when she went back to school where a major hostage situation had taken place. She didn't stop at documenting the school and the former hostages and said she had them draw on her photographs. And when she finally began to work with her father, from whom she'd been so long estranged, she made a set out of the act so that they could co-produce pictures of the development of their relationship. Only in her most recent project has she completely let go of the notion that picturing reality is more authentic than creating it. She cast people to play the roles crucial to her family's story of migration, referred overall to the soap opera that was the first to be introduced to the Soviet Union, and also that guided her mother's choice to move to California, and engaged a screenwriter from the original 1980s soap opera, Santa Barbara, to write a script of her own family's drama, which she didn't use per se, but it's in the book. Her mother talked to the actress who played her mother in the film, allowing for conversation that led Markosyan to believe that the authenticity she'd achieved in this project was more real than in any prior documentary project. This is true of another artist who owns her post-Soviet identity in as complicated a space as do Makhacheva, Lavrotsy, Markosyan, or any of the artists I will mention. What right indeed do any of us have to this category of the post-Soviet? What right have I? What is your relationship to it, indeed, as a listener? But in the meantime, Ira Eduardovna, who left Uzbekistan for Israel and then New York City, only to return as an adult to Uzbekistan in 2018. Before she went to her ostensible home there, which of course was no longer the same place as it had been when she had left before the fall, she collaborated with seven local actresses at the Ilkham Theater in Tashkent. None of these actresses had ever left Tashkent, and so they each add their interpretation of what it means for Ira to come home to the scene they perform. The first actress performs the return and asks the current tenants if she can come in. The second channel video includes Ira's direction. The first actress then performs the role of a director on the second actress. The whole game becomes a matryoshka, or a game of telephone. What does it mean to go home? How should I behave? Especially when that home is not the same home that one would have left when Ira did. You see in Eduardovna's work always this notion of echo chambers of representation, a real life housed in its memory. And the forms the work takes are theatrical even without a stage. In this case, female bodies pull a room out of a house, the women functioning as a mechanism between indoor and outdoor space. Chekhov Street and the library room, this one, and indeed most of Eduardovna's work recall the early 20th avant-garde project of Khutimas, the portable furniture meant to facilitate the political existence of the proletariat, which was actually directed, Grotchenko was the metal shop director at Khutimas. This furniture folded, it functioned. You could play chess and then move the entire furniture around. And in Eduardovna's recall of that revolutionary design in the context of migration and memory and gendered labor around how that works, you have a new project for a new century, for Lavrovsky's new baby, his perhaps reform. Edwardovna's work recovers not only that revolutionary objecthood, but the vernacular space of game shows popular in the USSR. That there then is only one of her projects based on reality TV, in this case, the iconic Soviet show What, Where, When. In the original game, a panel of experts brainstorms answers to questions sent in by viewers. In her representation, her actual family competes against a family of actors, and I perceive them as no longer really wanting to play. But if Edwardovna's video installations contend with the desire or lack thereof to return to the game her family had abandoned, if that question set defines her, however far away she lives, as a post-Soviet artist, what if someone who was born in the U.S., trained in the U.S., and whose primary geopolitical relationship to the USSR is through the proxy war her family's country fought with them, albeit a really important one. Does non-alignment and then really, really proximate relations define you as a post-Soviet subject? Mariam Ghani is a filmmaker who worked as part of Garage's field research program on a film called What We Left Unfinished. It takes five films made from within the nationalized film industry and poses of them the question, what is this state we once tried to imagine? And why? I think this sense of civic imagination with which I began, the will to push back against the rock, despite knowing that it will not move from its threatening posture and really flatten the village, I think that that's a common thread for these artists. I see it too in Paulina Kanas's work. She was born in Russia and educated there, although she now, I believe, lives in Amsterdam. New Flag of 2012 shows Kanas trying and trying to get on a horse and falling off again and again. This video is shown alongside a photograph of the horsewoman having succeeded in mounting her horse, sitting with perfect posture and holding a ridiculous flag. What is the mechanism of creating such a perfect representation? It's a joke. She did something like this again in 2014 with Formal Portrait, in which the culture of parades, so common to the Soviet space, is represented in a repetitious motif with no audience. As she says, ceremonial for a victory that will never come. Kanas looks at one thing at a time, one building block of national identity at a time. In lesson, a group of students answer questions relative to the pictures they're shown by their teachers, but the questions are only whistles. Kanas blows and blows, but the students appear to know the questions as much as they know the answers. Cultural codes and metanarratives are so embedded in their thinking that they don't even need language to know how they're expected to respond. It's a posture she looks at in the elderly as much as the young, leading people in a workout in a Moscow park, as a strange hybrid of totalitarian sports aesthetics, New Age pop culture, and the Soviet ideal of harmonic physical development. Encouraged by their young, strong leader, the more elderly crowd warms up and then moves on to the march. Alexandra Mitlanskaya works on this issue as well, but without her own performativity, showing instead within a static frame here, the many, many viewers who pay respects daily at Stalin's personal train in Georgia, or the effort involved in preparing to perform participation in the group. And in work less about then and more about now, she shows a new group, those who build and labor now. She just shows, she doesn't comment, right? I think that when I see artwork from Amagul Melibayeva, a Kazakhstani artist looking at landscapes, I see someone hoping to transform them. It's a new constructivism that takes the landscape of ruined porn and says that if this is what is, it's kind of great. What's been left behind is like the artifacts of a civilization that can be reinvented as it's resuscitated. Here, for example, she calls this mechanistic panel an altar of the East. Why not? And indeed, spirituality is not something to forget in this context. As much as pornography or non-alignment with the goals of the proletariat was taboo in the Soviet space, so was religion. And so to see Saudat Ismailova looking at women's spiritual practices, the relationship between nature and the female body, and the presence of female characters in collective memory, that's a part of recovery as well. And she showed syncretic verses alongside works completed in the last 5 years. She apparently showed texts from books of ethnographers and anthropologists who have researched Central Asia during the last century. For me, she said, this exhibition is also a desire to revive interest in the rich heritage of research of Central Asia, represented by a variety of scientists. I would like to share with the people of Tashkent how I shape my language and vision that lies behind my work. literature also accompanying video from about spiritual life and et cetera, invites viewers to actively participate in the experience of the on-screen image showing a woman lying motionless in the twilight. This project, a video installation in France, was motivated by her thoughts about her grandmother's attitude towards dreams. Every morning, her grandmother would ask her her dream, and when she didn't like it, she sent her to the sink so that the water would cleanse her. She wanted to make a piece about dreams, but it wasn't until after she had made a number of documentaries about the music of Central Asia and traveled around the region that she thought about the river there, the Amudarya, and began to collect the dreams of people living on the banks of the river, what they had once told the river. She describes the river as changing over its course the way life does, being born, growing fat, maturing, and she talks about trying to get into the memory of the river itself. So Ismailova is recovering a kind of spirituality local to Uzbekistan, which resists the meta-narrative of what that looks like in Russia. What does Uzbek spirituality look like in Russia or elsewhere? Recovers the past of practices and makes it present. And she did this in this case at the Ilkhom Theater in Tashkent, which is a place that has recurred several times kind of quietly over the course of this talk. Ira Eduardovna worked with it as well, for example, as has Garaj. It's an important space in this arena, the first non-state theater in the former USSR, started by a Ukrainian Jewish man, queer, who was actually murdered. It's an inclusive and experimental space. So I actually feel really kind of confident about how much it's possible to open up what's depicted in this picture from the series with which I opened about the space inside people's minds. And I feel confident that people are making spaces and that in pictures such as these by Tatiana Grigorenko, whose family left Russia as dissidents, we can start to see some more of these spaces spoken about from people inside of the communities they're trying to represent. She made these in Ukraine during the Maiden Revolution of 2014, when revolutionaries appropriated public space to suit their purposes. Using anything that happened to be on hand, she says, they gave life to a new territory designed to house and protect their spontaneous quasi-utopian community. I don't know if it's utopian, but it's real, right? So while it's easy to kind of focus on the laws and civic practices that censor artists from engaging with politics, there are just so many organizations in the area of post-Soviet space that support this kind of development of subjectivity. From Что делать, which I mentioned at the beginning, as an example of a Marxist collective, which operates a very important school in St. Petersburg, the Roses House of Culture, in the fairly horizontal structure of which many young artists find their way towards political practices of their own. But there are so many other kinds of constructs that I believe kind of turn on the notion of collective, the collective as an institution and the institution as collective. Working, for example, in feminism and gender and sexual identity, including the Nadyanka Creative Association here, or the Kriolex Center, for example, which describes itself as an imaginary institution that speaks on behalf of unclassified multitude of creatures embodied and ghostly, representing translocal queer imaginaries. And it's curated exhibitions in Kazakhstan and Azerbaijan. CEC ArtsLink is an institution I would spend a lot of time on, but they can spend it for you themselves. Their programs over 70 years of experience working with partners around Russia, Central Asia, and the Caucasus through kind of collaborations, exchanges, performances, professional development workshops, and short-term residencies, and you know, an annual kind of programming that includes this year, you know, Zooms even from the Congo about the state of work there and from all other post-Soviet affiliates. It's very, very important. And it, you know, is the way I first managed to go to Russia. So I'm always going to be grateful there. I've mentioned Garaj also throughout this talk, and I want to touch on how a couple of the elements of their program that now support post-Soviet affiliated artists, such as their studios at Vedenha, including childcare for those who need it, But especially I want to mention their experimentation and kind of serious playfulness, such as is represented through their current triennial of contemporary art, A Beautiful Night for All the People. Because as much as this is happening in individual artists, it's happening also in exhibition practices, right? The idea of creating spaces for subjectivity. In this case, the triennial was organized around principles of transparency. Artists from the 2017 triennial could name anyone they liked to participate in this iteration, as long as they were honest about why. Curators Valentin Diakonov and Anastasia Yushina were suspicious of expertise in a multinational state of great cultural and social diversity and wanted to highlight the kinds of personal connections that play a role in the region's self-organization. So, for example, Alexander Morozov was nominated by Alexander Shishkin Hokusai through a lottery, and Taos Makhacheva, with whom I opened, recommended Shamil Ahmed on the basis of their relationship as conversationalists. But Garage is more than an exhibition space, albeit as I've characterized it here, one playfully and intellectually nimble and supportive of artists. It's also very much a place for research. And perhaps in that way, more than in any other, it functions as a network for people across multiple backgrounds. Their field research program that supports investigations such as Mariam Ghani's project on Afghanistan also supported Cynthia Medensky's project on Esfir Shub, which is the last of my slides. As a final project to suggest for the Soviet post-Soviet space of subjectivity, Esfir by Cynthia Medensky. Medensky was born in the States and made this work through affiliation with Esfir's feminist avant-garde project. Esfir had believed that after the Bolshevik Revolution, women could be anything they wanted to be, and yet she couldn't get her script made. Medensky went into this project as a collaboration, as a co-production, and all of the projects that I've seen made in the former Soviet Union by artists on fellowships from without, Cynthia's was run really well. Not only did she meet with and ask questions of all the kind of possible people to contribute to the film and research very thoroughly, but, you know, named them as collaborators, paid them. And in any case, aside from the structure of her project, Medensky used Shub's script and Shub's idea as a container for work inside communities that Medensky was meeting herself. So Shub had intended to live with four women and make a documentary about them. But in the end, she made a fantastical thing. So that's what Medensky did. She, the beginning and the end of the film are made with women working on the project with her in multiple capacities. But the four main segments of the film mirror Shub's plan itself, depicting through each woman respectively labor. This is Anna, who draws and works. Motherhood through Alelush. And these are stills from the video. All of these videos obviously are audio in Russian, but there's some English text. The other, as depicted by Aim ends up being someone who works with migrants, but also is a girl from Kyrgyzstan and contemplates her space, her identity as such within the film. And then finally, a sex worker, Mila. These were the kinds of categories that Shub was interested in. And Medensky, like the other artists that I've been looking at here, is recovering this kind of revolutionary project and testing its confines as a potential for the relay of the subjective stance, right? So Medensky ends the film with a reading from Shub's script, with which I'll kind of end too, because I've come to this kind of moment in my research in which I'm looking at the state of being a post-Soviet artist as a state of choice, how much one chooses to affiliate, how much one chooses to recover and represent in this kind of rich arena of trial and error, and how much, you know, you want that to cycle back into the meta-narrative, not just when Pussy Riot runs onto the field at the World Cup, but really in terms of handling the past present and future in public. Maybe it's an imagined space of like trying harder and failing harder than happens in most places, but I think it's responsible and socially committed to speak for itself, to speak for oneself. The issues raised by these artists and so many more that I couldn't include, about what it's like to perform insiderness or outsiderness of any kind, to defy the premises of socialist realism as much as the current anti-propaganda laws or circumstances of redefined ethnic identity, and to resist the meta-narrative of visual culture. These are all good lessons inside and outside of post-Soviet space. And at this point, they're in this performative lens-based language that translates across regional boundaries and should, because, you know, there's a lot. There's, as Medansky puts here, as Shub wrote in her script, there's so much more to tell. That's it, Fariza.
All right, thank you so much for this incredible talk and bringing all this variety of these incredible, really a lot of them subaltern artists who, you know, sort of reflect against sort of this idea of their civic imagination and these changing themes of ethnicity, authenticity, migration, gender, labor, from sort of coming from the Soviet meta narrative to really a conversation about history, agency. And I love how you said really art making and creating sort of space for subjectivity in a post-Soviet space, however you define it. But I was really struck by so many works, and I'm just like really overwhelmed by, you know, the conversation that is sort of is happening in Russia versus the sort of, again, the subaltern sort of scholars speaking about their own history. So thank you so much for that. And we have a lot of questions and not a lot of time, but let's just, you know. So question number one, could you speak to the government and general public perception of these art topics, exhibitions and public and specific pieces? Is it generally supportive and or positive?
You know, I don't, I'm sure there are better people to ask in terms of, you know, the local curatorial presence, but my feeling is that a lot of the spaces that I have visited, Garage, the Street Art Museum in St. Petersburg, are places that are kind of enjoyed by an art viewing public as representative of notions of progress and progress, which is not a word that I want to associate with them, but as far as how they're received, I do think they're received as places, as sites of progress towards kind of a lot of different kinds of pleasure, and yet of course. You know, who goes to these places? So this is a question that we have in the States as well, which is to say, you can make as subversive an effort as you like in an art institution, but how do you get people into that institution feeling welcomed there, who may be the real goal of a work's audience, right? So newspapers like Nasreddin in Russia, you know, the goal there is to create something that gets out. Websites like Ozine, the goal there is to create something that gets out. Even Lavrovsky's game is something that can potentially get out, because even though it's housed with an institution, it's digital. So I think, other kinds of exhibition strategies like that are very much native to this region don't rely on big institutions like Garage, but instead are cited in some of the kind of local museums that are topical, like the Museum of Communication in St. Petersburg, or Museum of Space, whatever. And I think institutions like CEC ArtsLink have been operative in supporting that kind of public dissemination. And other kinds of curatorial programs, I think, are supportive of that kind of grassroots movement of ideas into public space. So I can't attest to the response of a public to each of these artworks. I do I do feel like part of that question has to do with what is a government response. And obviously, when you see someone like Yulia imprisoned for her efforts, or Pussy Riot members imprisoned, you understand that there is pushback against certain projects, but not all of them. And I think that's always an interesting thing to see when there's pushback and when there isn't, right?
Yeah, the follow-up sort of question is, do you see this hegemonic narrative mirrored in current events in Russia and the US? How do you think artists might combat this given the overwhelming amount of information directed at audiences right now?
I do see it mirrored in the US, don't you? I mean, I think that artists working on these topics of migration and memory and owning a space for their identities, I think, you know, I've even heard or read Makhacheva talk about how, you know, it's not actually interesting to be categorized regionally all the time. In fact, you want what you say about migration or et cetera to kind of have implications for people experiencing that in other contexts. And certainly in California, you know, on this border, we have narratives around insiderness and otherness that need to be worked on, and you know, reproductive rights are being threatened, and et cetera, et cetera. So I think there's a lot to mirror between the strategies in different countries, and I think that it would behoove us to probably look at these works in conjunction with one another and see which strategies are shared. I see a lot of bodily performative work that's reflected in kind of multi-pronged mediatic products as what's especially happening, right? Like people who are both trying to be didactic and teach, create materials that can be disseminated, and then also create work for art spaces. Wu Sang's project of a number of years ago, where she created a documentary, as it were, about attendees of a queer club in LA. The product that was created there was a movie that they could watch, that they had kind of co-produced, right? But it was also a movie about them. And then when it was shown at the Whitney Biennial, it was also recreated as a space. So there are different kinds of strategies for speaking to different audiences that may be attracted on the one hand to film, as Soviet propaganda understood, right? The film is a media of the masses, but then in kind of a space that allows for more elaboration, like a context like Garage, in this case the Whitney, you know, you create a space for thinking about it more elaborately, maybe.
That also reminds me of Savitsky, who managed, you know, to sort of smuggle all that work, which was non-socialist realist, in the museum way far and Nukus, you know, which is in Karakalpakstan, Pakistan, sort of, you know, and it was just too far, and the government basically couldn't get, and there was that space in the midst of this desert basically booming.
Yes.
What do you think American artists could learn from their international counterparts that you've described so far?
I think that we're all working on how, you know, what's a moment at which didacticism is important? What's a moment at which speaking for the self is important? And what are ways in which we can perform allyship without constantly seeming didactic? You know, the Russian space is so playful and so subversive in its playfulness, and I see that in a lot of the work about queer identity and Latinx identity in California. I see a lot of people, you know, Alexandra Sagade plays with superheroes. I could put together a show, absolutely, that would include like Alexandra Sagade's work on superheroes, Yoshua Kon's work with like meditating parking attendants, a lot of work about the absurd in the United States, but I think maybe it's not even that the artists need to learn from one another, it's that the way that we talk about and organize the artworks needs to learn from the different systems. I think in the United States, we have such a market-based art world that the kind of valuation of artist strategies is sublimated to the notion of the collector's provision of value to the work. And as long as collectors are driving who has institutional exhibitions or what the work costs or et cetera, imagining that they're, shooting people off into an art historical future, we're in the wrong space. And I think what I see as a kind of a global trend is this centering of this subject who speaks for themselves and the institution who supports that, and those voices really becoming revalued as the leaders of the art historical narrative. I think it's the only way forward, is to imagine that artists and thinkers are the ones who are retraining a civic imagination and therefore defining what's valuable.
Well, on this fantastic note, we are running out of time, and I want to thank you once again for this really remarkably rich presentation, touching upon so many themes. I want to also thank everyone for tuning in, and please follow our announcement on the Davidson Center website. And also, we have a Facebook page, Gender Socialism and Post-Socialism Group, and follow for our updates there as well. Farah, thank you so much again.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. On this note, we're going to finish our presentation.